Have you ever wondered how to streamline the approval process without endless emails and losing track of requests? In my school group, we recently tackled a use case of how to create an approval flow using Power Automate to track training requests. In our scenario, the training request is submitted to Microsoft Lists using a built-in form, and then Power Automate is going to pick up that information and route it to three different managers in a specific order. If any of the managers rejects the request, the flow will stop, and then the employee will get an email letting them know why their request was rejected. Before we build the flow, let's look at how the data was set up to support the approval process and the Power Automate flow. A list was created to keep track of the training requests. It has columns for the employee name, email, the course, and if the person took the training before and when. In this scenario, some of the training has a recertification requirement. There are also columns to specify the three people who have to approve the training and to capture the status of the approval for each step. In the real use case, we had several other columns, such as a description, a place to keep track of approver comments, cost of the training, etc. But for this demonstration, I'm going to keep it simple. There are a couple of ways to set up the approver columns. You can use a people picker, which will allow the employee to type in the name of their supervisor and pull in all of the information from the global address list so that you don't have to worry about typos. The other option is to use a choice column where you specify the names and email addresses of the supervisors. But I don't recommend this because what happens is when people come and go from the organization, you have to update the training request list in order for it to remain accurate. And I can tell you from experience, the last thing that anybody is thinking about as an employee is changing jobs is updating the training list. And so therefore, the process tends to break. So in my opinion, I think using the people column is more efficient. Another requirement for this scenario is we don't want the employee to see all of the columns or to see information related to other people's requests because there is sensitive information gathered. The most efficient way to add the information to the list is to use the built-in forms feature. I already created a form for this list, but when you create your form, all of the columns will be included as questions. To take a question off the form, remove the check mark next to the column that should not be included. Now, by default, the name of the column is the name of the question, but you can click in each one of the boxes to update it to something that's more specific. So for example, the when column is not specific enough. I would change that to say, when was the last time you attended training? When you're done making your changes, go to the Send tab to get a link. You can provide the link to your employees in multiple ways, such as adding it to your training page in SharePoint, putting a link in a training request guide, or sending it via Teams, whatever makes sense to your business process. Now that we've reviewed the data setup, it's time to go to Power Automate and create the flow. So to get started, I'm going to click on Create in the left-hand navigation menu, and we're going to start with an automated cloud flow. First, we're going to give the flow a name. Then we're going to choose our trigger for this automated cloud flow. And in this case, it's going to be when an item is created for a SharePoint list. Then click Create. To set up the trigger, we can click on the card and it's going to open up a pane on the left-hand side of the screen where we can update the parameters. The first thing that we're going to do is tell Power Automate what SharePoint site the list is associated with. Now, in this case, my SharePoint site is already in the drop-down list, but if you don't see yours, you can go to the bottom and click Enter Custom Value and paste in a URL. But I'm going to go ahead and select mine from the list. Now that Power Automate knows what SharePoint site to look for, it's going to only show you lists associated with that site. So in this case, it's going to be the training request case study. And that's all we need to set up the trigger. Now what we're going to do is we're going to click on the plus sign to add the action and search for the approvals connector. From the standard approval section, I'm going to choose start and wait for an approval. Then from the drop-down box, we need to select an approval type. Now we have a couple choices here. You can either create a single approval or a sequential approval. With sequential, you will add multiple names. Then the application will route the request in the order that you specified. In this use case, we are using a sequential approval logic, but I'm going to build one step at a time because we want to insert additional information in between the approval steps. Now that we've selected the approval type, we need to add a title. And in this case, I'm going to start with dynamic content to pull the employee name in from the SharePoint list. Now it happens that this is in the first column of the list, which is always called title. Even if you rename it, Power Automate still thinks of it as title. So in this case, it's going to be equivalent to the employee name has submitted a training request. And then the next thing we're going to do is choose who to assign the approval to. Now in this field, you don't see dynamic selection right away. First, you have to click on the little dropdown next to the gear icon for settings and then tell Power Automate, I want to use dynamic content. If you just type a name in here, it's going to always send it to that name only. And that's not what we need for this particular scenario because there are different supervisors based on who the employee is. In the dynamic content, we're only seeing a few fields, but there are several more available. You can click on See More to get the full list, or you can use the search bar. In this case, I'm going to use the search to pull in the supervisor's email address. Now, because I use the people picker as part of the list, all of this information is coming from the global address list. So again, you don't have to worry about typos. You can use the details section to add additional comments to the approval and provide instructions. So for example, I could use the dynamic content to pull in the employee name and then say something like they are requesting training and verify that they are within the window. You can also add a link to the SharePoint item to make it easier for the approver to find any related information. So in the search bar, I'm going to start typing item, and what we want is link to item. Now I would like to draw your attention down to the advanced parameters, and there are two things that are automatically turned on, notifications and reassignment. Reassignment basically means that whoever you assigned the approval to can assign it to somebody else. With the notifications turned on, the approver is automatically going to get an activity notification in Teams as well as an email. Now, we can create custom emails in Power Automate, but I suggest using the built-in emails because it will include an accept or reject button as well as a place to enter the comments to streamline the process and make it easier for people to respond to these requests. The next thing we're going to do is add another action, and this time it's going to be a condition control, which will allow us to take different steps based on whether or not the supervisor approved or rejected the request. So to set this up, we're going to choose a value, and from dynamic selection, we're going to use the outcome of the approval step, and we're going to say it's equal to approve. Now this is case sensitive, so the A in approve is always capitalized. Before we move on, I realized I forgot a step in the start and wait for approval action. Because we're gonna add multiple approvals, it's always a good idea to rename each one of the actions to make them easier to differentiate as we start adding more information. And then I'm also going to rename the condition control so that it's easier to read the flow and know which steps are associated with which actions. Now we are going to start building the true path of the condition control. So if the supervisor approved, we're going to do a couple things. The first is we're going to start another approval and send it to the next manager on the list. So once again, we're going to go for start and wait for an approval. And to make it easier to find, I'm going to click on this little star to put it in my favorites list for later. Just like before, I'm going to rename the step and call it start and wait for manager's approval. And then we're going to select an approval type and fill it out just like we did the start and wait for supervisor approval. For the title, I'm going to use dynamic content to show the supervisor's name, then say that they've already approved the training for the employee's name. And then I'm going to use dynamic content in the assigned to field to go back to SharePoint and get the manager's email address. And then the other fields you can fill in just like I showed you in the first step. The next thing we want to do on the true path is add an action to update the SharePoint list with the supervisor's response. So we're going to search for update item in the SharePoint list of connectors. I'm going to change the name of the step to reflect that this is associated with the supervisor step, specify the SharePoint address, and the list name. Now what we're going to do is use dynamic content to pull in the ID of the item that triggered the flow, so we're updating the right line on the list. Now you're not expected to know this ID number. It's something that Power Automate just pulls from the background. So notice that the employee email address and the course are required entries in Power Automate. This doesn't always happen, and I haven't figured out why Power Automate does this sometimes and at other times it doesn't. But what I'm going to do is pull this in from when an item is created to basically say the email address that was originally provided is still the same email address. And I'm going to do the same thing with the course requirement. Now we're going to go down to advanced parameters and click show all to see all the columns and then go down to the supervisor approval column. We're going to use dynamic content to grab the outcome of the supervisor's approval and copy it to SharePoint. Now here you can see why I said we need to rename our steps because we have a manager and a supervisor approval. If they had the same name with a number behind it, it's much easier to make a mistake and pull in the wrong information. With that done, we can start building the false side of the approval. So if the supervisor rejects, we're going to send the employee an email. On the to line, we're going to use dynamic content to pull in the employee's email address from the when an item is created step. Then for the subject line, you can put any information you want, but in this example, I'm pulling in the supervisor's name and then just saying that the request was rejected. In the body of the email, you can put anything that makes sense for your business process. For this example, I'm instructing the employee to look at the approval for the comments and make any updates if required. Now, the employee can go to the approvals app and they can see those comments, or we can use dynamic content once again to add in the comments directly into the email. When you select responses, comments, Power Automate inserts a for each step to the flow because there's a possibility that there could be more than one comment and the flow needs to loop through them all to put them in the email. On the false side, we also want to update the SharePoint list with the supervisor's rejection. Now, instead of building this again, I can right-click over Update Approval, select Copy, and then right-click over the Add an Action button and select Paste an Action. And this will insert the update step into the flow, and all I have to do is rename it to reflect that this is the reject action. I want to pause here for a moment because every time I create a flow, I always test it. And in this case, I realize I missed a step right here, which is to add a termination control to the if false side of the flow, which I will show at the end of the video. For the next part of the flow, we're going to add an action and choose another condition control so that we can do the same type of logic with the manager's approval. A lot of this is the exact same thing as we did before. We're going to look for the outcome, but this time we're going to look for the outcome from the manager's approval. So if the outcome is equal to approve, what is the true path going to do? This time I'm going to build it a little bit different so that you can see options, but ideally you would pick a logic and then stick with that through the entire flow. From my favorites list, I'm going to select update item and then use the same SharePoint site, the same list that we've been using. But then on the ID step under dynamic content, I want you to notice that there are multiple SharePoint steps. For this, we want to use when an item is created to pull the ID from the trigger. Just like before, Power Automate made employee address and course mandatory in the parameters. And then we're going to scroll down and we're going to update the manager approval step and pull in the outcome from start and wait for manager approval. We also want the SharePoint list to be updated on the false side of the condition. So we're just going to copy and paste that over. And then the only thing we need to do is update the name of the step. Everything else is already the same. Just like we did in the supervisor step, we're going to add an action to send an email. I'm going to choose send an email V2 because this is tied to your Microsoft 365 Outlook account for your work. I'll update the name of the step and then add in the employee's name on the to line, the subject, and the body of the email. Now, once again, you will put in whatever information makes sense for your business process. We have one last manager that needs to approve, so we're going to add another action, select start and wait for approval, and choose our approval type. Then you're going to fill in all of the information just like we did before. Now we're going to add the last condition control for the senior manager. We're still going to take the outcome of their approval and update the SharePoint list. But this time, both true and false will trigger an email to the employee, letting them know the final outcome of their training request. After you create your flow, I always suggest that you test it because even though Power Automate will save it and say your flow is ready to go, there are some things that it's not going to catch. So in this case, I ran two different tests. The first test was to have everybody approve and make sure that the approval steps worked. The test worked fine until we got to the start and wait for senior manager approval. The reason it failed is I'd accidentally selected the senior manager's name from dynamic content instead of the email, and the assigned to field requires an email. When I fixed that, I ran a second test to make sure that everything worked if somebody rejected a request. Technically, the flow did work, but not as intended. When the supervisor rejected, the SharePoint list was updated and the employee did get an email. But the flow continued to wait for the manager approval and the senior manager approval, even though there wasn't a step in the flow to create that approval. So what I needed to do was come back and on the false side, add a terminate action to end the flow. The status on terminate can be failed or succeeded. And in this case, I chose succeeded because it's doing exactly what I want. When the first person rejects, I want to stop the approval process. And then I went to the condition control for the manager approval, and then I added another termination step so that if either the manager or the supervisor reject, the flow will stop. And then everything worked for the senior manager step because we were already at the end of the flow. So that's how we built the Power Automate approval process based on the training request use case where we wanted to take some of that information and copy it over to Microsoft Lists. Now, there are multiple ways to build an approval process, and if you don't need to transfer the information and you just want to capture the approval, you can do the whole thing with the built-in approvals app in Microsoft Teams, and it is much easier to set up. So that's all for this video. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.